Good morning, everyone. My name is John Bonifaz. I'm the co-founder and president of Free Speech for People, and we will be starting now with this press conference. Thank you all for being here. Free Speech for People, along with Roots Action, launched moments after the president took his oath of office, impeachdonaldtrumpnow.org, a campaign seeking an impeachment investigation of President Trump based on his direct and serious violations of the Constitution the moment he took the oath of office. The president was repeatedly warned prior to the inauguration that he would be in violation of the Foreign Emoluments Clause and the Domestic Emoluments Clause if he did not fully divest from his business interests prior to taking the oath of office. He did not fully divest, and he now must face the consequences of accountability via the impeachment process. We're here today to discuss this impeachment campaign and to announce the delivery this afternoon to the United States Congress of more than 850,000 petitions calling for this investigation from people all over the country. Our first speaker will be Ron Fein, legal director for Free Speech for People.
Thank you. As you know, President Trump has displayed a casual indifference to the law in general, but nowhere is this more striking than in his use of the presidency for his own personal and private profit. In our call for an impeachment investigation, we have focused on two specific violations of the United States Constitution that we know for a fact that President Trump is in violation, and just as importantly, that these are well established as grounds for impeachment. And when we talk about the corruption of the presidency, it's easy to get lost in technical terms like emoluments. And as a lawyer, of course, I'm happy to do that. But it's important to understand that what President Trump is doing by enriching himself through the presidency is not only unconstitutional, it's not only immoral, but it's actually fundamentally corrupting of the republic to profit from the presidency at public expense. And he's doing this in two main ways that violate specific provisions of the Constitution. The first is by taking money from foreign governments. The founders of the Constitution were actually quite concerned about federal officials being influenced by payments from foreign states, and they put a provision in the Constitution known as the Foreign Emoluments Clause or the Foreign Corruption Clause that specifically prohibits these types of arrangements. The second category is enriching himself from the public treasury. And again, the founders may not have anticipated every particular angle of the president's grift, but they did put a provision in the Constitution. And it's called the Domestic Emoluments Clause, or also known as the Presidential Compensation Clause. It provides that the president is paid with a fixed salary that's set by Congress for his entire term of office, and not a penny more. But what President Trump is doing is using the treasury as a kitty for travel to his own resorts and hotels and rent in his buildings so that he can enlarge his salary from the Treasury without complying with this provision of the Constitution. Now, to be sure, not every violation of the law or even of the Constitution is necessarily grounds for impeachment. The standard in the Constitution is that president can be impeached for treason, bribery, or other high crimes and misdemeanors. It's ultimately up to the Congress to determine what count as high crimes or misdemeanors, but as we have cited in the legal analysis at the impeachdonaldtrumpnow.org website, the founders of the Constitution were actually quite clear on this specific point. One of the leading founders, Edmund Jennings Randolph, who was confronted at the Virginia Ratifying Convention with an argument against adoption of the Constitution on the grounds that the president might be too powerful and too subject to outside influence, cited these provisions, the Foreign Emoluments Clause and the Domestic Emoluments Clause, and said, if discovered, he may be impeached. That's where we are now. I want to close with a note that the examples of impeachable violations that we've cited in the legal analysis at impeachdonaldtrumpnow.org and that I've talked about today may not be the end of it. In the coming weeks, we will be working with our distinguished legal advisory board, which includes Professor Ross, and which you can see on the impeachdonaldtrumpnow.org website, to update that analysis, considering what President Trump has done so far in office. And of course, once an impeachment investigation is launched, Congress may decide to expand the scope. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron. Our next speaker will be Norman Solomon, the co-founder and coordinator of Roots Action.
In addition to the five voices that you will hear up at this microphone today, there are other voices far more important that will be heard in the future. The 870,000 people who, as of this morning, have signed the petition at impeachdonaldtrumpnow.org live in every community of the United States. That number continues to grow. We know that in a matter of days it will cross the 1 million threshold and keep going. Those names are much more than letters on a printed page or pixels on a screen. They're people who care deeply about the Constitution, who understand that it's a fundamental precept of democracy that no one is above the law, that the most powerful position of the U.S. government must not be occupied by someone who has shown willingness, even eagerness, to violate fundamental precepts of the Constitution. And what we're going to be seeing that may not yet be apparent from Capitol Hill is that around the United States, not only the signers of this petition so far, but many, many millions of other people believe deeply that when the people lead, the leaders will follow. And this petition campaign is based on that concept. So the petition is only one part of what is going to begin to unfold in the next several weeks. And that is that in every congressional district in this country, people have already begun and will continue in greater numbers to contact their representative in the House and to say in no uncertain terms that no one is above the law, and that in this situation, whatever the partisan affiliation of the member of the House, it's imperative to launch a formal impeachment investigation. Now, we sometimes hear the skepticism, maybe even cynicism, that nothing's going to happen in the House on impeachment because most of the members are Republicans. And I think we need to remind ourselves that history tells us something very different. When in 1974, the House Judiciary Committee voted on impeachment, on three articles of impeachment of the Republican president, Richard Nixon, out of the 38 members of that committee, seven Republicans voted for impeachment. And there are many strong reasons, not only in history, but in our current political situation, to believe that large numbers of members of the House, whatever their party, are going to be feeling the heat. And that heat has begun. And next week, the temperature will rise as members go back to their districts, some of them holding town hall meetings, some of them being visited by their constituents to press this point. And so in closing, I want to emphasize that the ImpeachDonaldTrumpNow.org campaign is not by any means only about a petition drive. This is about an awakening democratic fervor at the grassroots that will bring about the impeachment of this president.
Thank you, Norman. Our next speaker is Professor Catherine Ross of George Washington University Law School. She is a member of our legal advisory board for this campaign at impeachdonaldtrumpnow.org.
Thank you, and thanks to all of you who came here today to cover this event. I'm a law professor. I'm also a historian and a constitutional scholar. And I joined the Legal Advisory Board for this effort because, like many other people, I believe we've entered uncharted territory, and I'm concerned about the fundamental future of our democratic institutions. Impeachment has been and should remain rare, and it shouldn't be undertaken lightly. But we also should not shy from using it when impeachment is called for. So I see my role here today as providing some legal perspective on the constitutional limits on presidential compensation. Alexander Hamilton, who advocated for a powerful executive, explained in Federalist Number 73 that the domestic emoluments or presidential compensation clause would forestall even inadvertent corruption. And it's an integral part of the separation of powers that are the structure of our government. The rule, Hamilton wrote, will ensure the legislature can neither weaken the president's fortitude by cutting his salary, nor corrupt his integrity by appealing to his avarice. Neither the federal government nor the individual states, Hamilton continued, will be at liberty to give, nor will he be at liberty to receive, any other emolument than the salary established before he took office. He can, of course, have no pecuniary inducement to renounce or desert the independence intended for him by the Constitution. The framers' goal was clear: to root out all potential for corruption in order to ensure that no temptations could interfere with the president's judgment respecting the nation's best interests and his ability to faithfully execute his oath. As Hamilton indicated, the corruption need not be conscious or intended. Even if the president's financial interests affect his judgment only inadvertently, the harms to the body politic are the same as if he intended to advance his own interests. The Constitution's mandatory limit on presidential compensation was designed to eliminate all personal economic temptations that might affect the president's policy decisions, including biases and inclinations of which the president himself might remain unaware. When the framers made it unconstitutional for the president to accept any form of benefit from other branches or levels of government, they eliminated the risk of even an appearance that any part of federal, state, or local government might influence the president through emoluments. Today, we rarely use that term, emoluments. And when we do, its meaning is limited to compensation or payment from employment, perhaps including perks like a company car. But the concept of emoluments extended much further when the Constitution was written. I followed the lead of the originalist approach to constitutional interpretation that is favored, well, was favored by Justice Scalia, is favored by President Trump, and many in Congress, to find out what emoluments meant to the founders. And I did that by consulting the leading dictionaries at the time the framers wrote the Constitution. And by the way, the dictionaries I used are the ones most frequently cited by the federal courts when they look to original meaning. Emoluments begin with what today we call a salary, or what they called profit from an office or employ, but they embrace much more. They include advantage and gains in general. Barclay's 1791 dictionary defines advantage, in turn, as a favorable opportunity. In mercantile affairs, a premium or profit greater than what can be obtained by law. Samuel Johnson's renowned dictionary, too, expressly defined advantage as favorable circumstances, overplus, something more than lawful gain, as well as to grow rich. In contemporary terms, overplus would include favorable negotiations and favorable tax or zoning rulings and sweetheart deals. Gains are much the same. Several dictionaries described gains as a synonym for profits or advantage, and more specifically, overplus in a comparative situation, in other words, a sweetheart deal. Webster's American Dictionary, published in 1830, adds to grow rich, and looking to the French roots of the word, something obtained as an advantage. So the Constitution clearly says that the president cannot receive any form of financial advantage from state or federal governments during his term. But while the clause doesn't specify the remedy that applies when a president violates this specific and very concrete provision of the Constitution, the rule is not waivable. It's embedded in the text of the Constitution. And unlike the Foreign Emoluments Clause, which specifically says that Congress has discretion to waive the rule with respect to particular gifts, there is no such congressional power here. This is an unwaivable rule. And therefore, the only possible remedy, the one that the Constitution contemplates, is impeachment, a remedy which is intended for injuries to society as a whole. Hamilton referred to these injuries as violations of some public trust. The nonpartisan Congressional Research Service reviewed the history and purpose of impeachment in 2015. It concluded that impeachment is appropriate for, quote, misconduct that damages the state, including constitutional wrongs that subvert the structure of government or undermine the integrity of the office and even of the Constitution itself. And the report reviewing all the impeachments of every form of government official at the federal level concluded that three categories of harm have historically led to impeachment in the United States. First, improperly exceeding or abusing the powers of office. Second, behavior incompatible with the function and purpose of the office. And third, misusing the office for personal gain. It seems that all three are implicated by the president's continued ownership in and benefit from his businesses in the United States and abroad.
Thank you, Professor Ross. Our last speaker before we open up for questions is Ben Clements. Ben is the chairman of the board of directors of Free Speech for People, founding partner of the Boston law firm of Clements and Pino, and a former federal prosecutor in Boston, as well as a former chief counsel to Governor Deval Patrick of Massachusetts, former Governor Deval Patrick.
Thank you, John, and thank you to all of you for coming out for this important announcement today. This campaign is about defending our constitutional democracy, and it's also a test. It's a test of the patriotism of all Americans. It's a test of the patriotism of Congress. Will we rise to this challenge, one of the greatest challenges our constitutional democracy has ever faced? We are confronted with a president who does not understand and does not respect our Constitution, who does not understand and respect our American traditions, our American values. This is a president who does not respect freedom of religion, who believes instead that he can dictate which religious groups will be protected and which religious groups will be excluded. A president who does not understand or respect freedom of speech and the press, but believes instead that he can dictate what the press and the public in general can say about him, about his administration, about his family, and about the affairs of the day. This is a president who does not believe and respect the free enterprise system, but instead believes that he can dictate to businesses that they shall support, promote, and buy the products and services made and sold by him and his family for profit. We're dealing with a president who does not respect the fundamental principle that no public official, especially the President of the United States, may allow his personal financial interest to interfere with the public interest that he is sworn to uphold. This is a president who believes that the presidency is simply an extension of his family business, there to facilitate more profits for him and his family. At bottom, this is a president who does not accept and appears to be incapable of accepting that he answers to the American people and not the other way around. We can again have a constitutional democracy or we can have a dictatorship, but we can't have both. These almost 900,000 signatures that we've brought to Washington, D.C. today represent millions and millions and millions more Americans who are answering that question and demanding a constitutional democracy. It's time for Congress to do the same thing. It's time for Congress to do their job and begin impeachment proceedings.
Thank you, Ben. We're now ready to open up for questions. If anyone has any, go ahead. Yes.
Are there any concrete examples of President Trump favoring his private interests over his public duty?
Ben, do you want, I mean, Ron, do you want to take that?
Yes, the question being concrete examples of President Trump favoring his private interest over public duties. You know, one of the most striking examples actually came during the election season with respect to Trump Towers in Istanbul, where he has two buildings, actually a pair. And Trump, over the course of the election campaign, was on the up and then on the down with the president of Turkey. So when he first called for a ban on Muslim immigration to the United States, the president of Turkey said the name Trump should be removed from those office towers. Then a little while later, when there was an attempted coup in Turkey, Donald Trump at that point said, well, actually, I support the president. And then the president of Turkey all of a sudden dropped his demand that the name Trump be removed from the towers. And Trump said at that point, he actually said to a reporter, I have a little conflict of interest with respect to Turkey because I have two office buildings there. So this is a perfect example of how in a problematic region of the world where there are very complex interests of the United States involved with a country that's an ally, but where there's also some tension, how Trump's swings of policy, where he admitted that he had a conflict of interest, seemed to be dictated by the prospect of having his name removed from an office building.
And Ben Clements also, I think, is going to address this.
So just to respond a little bit, elaborate on what Ron said. Now, these direct connections, of course, are very hard to definitively prove. But there is evidence from which compelling inferences can be made. Take, for example, President Trump's recent attempts to ban people from certain countries coming in, certain countries coming into our country, supposedly based on fear of terrorism. The countries whose people were banned included a series of countries in the Middle East from which no person is known to have ever committed a terrorist act resulting in the death of any American. Excluded from the ban were several countries, including Saudi Arabia, which of course has had a number of people responsible for terrorist deaths of Americans, including many of the 9/11 hijackers, and several other Middle Eastern countries that all had one thing in common. And that one thing in common is that Donald Trump does business in each of those countries. He doesn't do business in any of the countries that were included in his ban. So one can argue there may have been other reasons, but it's striking how those line up. And the inferences, as I said, are compelling. But the broader point that I'd like to make is the reason, as Professor Ross outlined so well, that the framers felt it important to put these ironclad rules regarding foreign and domestic emoluments in the Constitution is because of the difficulty in establishing that an officer or the president in particular's judgment has been compromised. And so it's not up to us to prove that. If the president is taking foreign emoluments, the Constitution essentially creates a presumption that his judgment will be impaired. And that's the reason we're calling on Congress to impeach or begin an impeachment investigation.
I Thank you, Ben. Any other questions?
Is there any precedent that a petition has worked to get a president impeached?
Well, to be clear, maybe Norman, do you want to take this question? I'll start, and then to add, to be clear, we're not saying that the petition alone is the basis for impeachment. We're asking for an impeachment investigation to proceed, for Congress to do its job of subpoenaing records, putting people under oath, and demonstrating whether or not the president has committed impeachable offenses. This is the start of the impeachment process, but not the conclusion of it. But Norman, do you want to add to that?
Yes, to briefly elaborate on that, the petition and the names on the petition all gathered since Inauguration Day, when the violation of the Constitution's Foreign and Domestic Emoluments Clauses began. Those names are markers, they're indicators, they're reflections of widespread concern, anger, and commitment from people around the country. And so, broadly, in answer to your question, there is precedent in terms of impeachment when those conditions exist and grow, as they're now growing in this country, to demand that the House of Representatives take action in the form of impeachment. And we lived through that period, those of us who are old enough to remember 1973 and 1974. That's really the dynamic. When at first the Watergate stories and the concerns were considered to be marginal, considered to be unrealistically projected to cause major political problems for then President Nixon, and the willingness and increasing commitment of people around the country to say this is not tolerable resulted in the House Judiciary Committee taking impeachment action. And I think that's a path, those are footsteps that we now, loosely speaking, have begun to walk in.
Any other questions? Yes.
I think a lot of people who might be sympathetic to you, the name Pence pops into their head. How do you respond to that?
Well, I'll start, and then I'll please ask others if they want to add to that. Our position, and we've answered this question on our website via our FAQ document, is that the removal, the impeachment and removal of the President of the United States will be clearly upholding our Constitution and our democracy. And any person becoming president as a result of that process, vice president becoming president, will be under even greater scrutiny to comply with the Constitution and the rule of law. Furthermore, it would be a very dangerous precedent to allow a president to trample on the Constitution, as this president is doing, and not hold him accountable through that process via the impeachment proceedings. So our position is that we need to uphold the Constitution and the rule of law here, and the follow-up will be that we have a stronger democracy for it.
There's increasing and I think well-founded concern that the United States government is careening towards dictatorship. And among the most important facets of dictatorship is that somebody at the top can flagrantly and with impunity violate the law. And by its own description, the Constitution of the United States is the supreme law of the land. So I think that becomes sort of job one for people, to make sure that this perhaps imminent occurrence doesn't actually happen. And the belief, and I certainly share it, is that if impeachment and then conviction by the Senate takes place, that the person who steps into the Oval Office, in this case, Mr. Pence, will be under great and recently demonstrated restraints and constraints to show that this is not going to fly as a country where the wealthy and powerful can say that the laws don't apply to them from the very top of the Oval Office. So from a principled standpoint of preserving democracy and preventing dictatorship, it's a no-brainer. It's necessary to impeach Trump. From a political calculus I think we could say with great justification that it's much better to have a successor in the White House who knows that the Congress and the people have just shown they won't tolerate flagrant violations of the Constitution, rather than doing some sort of calculus to accept a status quo that should be intolerable.
Professor Ross, do you want to answer this question or any other matters that have come up thus far?
I'll just add to that, because a number of people have asked me that question. And my response is that that shows that this is not about politics. This is not about being disgruntled about who won the election. Because if you were to look at it from a political standpoint, Vice President Pence is a very conservative man. And I'm not thinking about the legislative proposals that he would put forward. He probably, you know, knowing the Constitution, knowing the government, would be more effective at pursuing his agenda than President Trump seems to be. But that isn't the issue here. This is about the fundamental constitutional structure of our government and preserving democracy. Because once you say that we're not even going to try to rein in this president, he's one of a kind, you lower the bar, and it becomes very impossible, very, very difficult to enforce rule of law in the future. We can't afford that.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? If not, thank you for coming. We invite Americans all over the country who have yet to join this campaign to join us at impeachdonaldtrumpnow.org. We'll be delivering these petitions this afternoon to Congress. Thank you.